There is nothing for which we cannot pray for, and there is nothing that God cannot do. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. Hi, my name is Ronnie Roque from Who Me Be a Leader. And here on Sunday morning, I want to talk to you about something that we don't do enough of, which is prayer. And I thought about that this morning as I was praying for my 12-year-old who's getting ready to go on a beach retreat, and she'll be gone for 7 days. And so one of the things that always challenged me to do is to pray for their family, to pray individual for each kid, to pray with their wife, to pray for their wife. Because we're under attack as we're in this fallen world, and we got to keep remembering that we are in a fallen world. So today I want to talk to you about prayer is what we need. So we're going to talk about that, and we're going to talk about five essentials when it comes down to prayer, and what God intended for us with prayer, because God wants us to communicate with Him. And we need to do that as a people because we need Him. I mean, we need Him in a bad way. And so we want to talk to you today about how do we cease from praying. Now, when you talk about prayer, a lot of us old timers are used to, as we was growing up, you know, the clasping of the hand and on the knees praying, and all that stuff is really good. But you can pray at all times. That's why Paul would say it, pray without ceasing. You can be riding to work and praying. You can be doing yard work praying. You can pray at all times. But the thing about it is that men do not pray enough. And that's why sometimes I find men who are afraid to pray in public. And they're afraid to pray in public because they're not praying in private. See, because when you're communicating with God in private, you don't really care about what the public say about your communication with God and how you communicate with God. Because not only that, a lot of times, we've seen pastors pray and lay leaders pray, and they got this pretty prayer. And so we thinking that we have to be that way. No, prayer is simply how you communicate with God. Just how you talk to people, you can talk to God that way. Now, this is the other thing that you have to understand. When we go into the throne, we have to cleanse ourselves. Because the scriptures say, who can ascend into heaven? Nothing but clean hands and pure hearts. We have to keep that in mind. So we want to talk about prayer, because remember, the veil has been torn. We don't need a priest to go in and pray for us. We can pray for ourselves. And so the thing about it is, I want to challenge men today about prayer. So let's look at the five essentials of what we're talking about with prayer. One thing, first of all, you want to know that prayer is the language that God has chosen in order for Him to communicate with His people. Prayer is the language that God has chosen in order for Him to communicate with His people. Remember in Hebrew, he said, long ago God spoke through signs and wonders, but today He's speaking through His word, Jesus Christ, which is His Son. And so we want to make that clear that God is speaking through His word. We have a lot of people coming up and saying to me, and I've had people come to me and say that, you know, say, God told me to tell you something. Well, if it's not in His word, then the fact is God didn't tell you to tell me that. Because number one, I have a relationship with God, and whatever God needs to say to you about me, He can say directly to me. So remember, God spoke through signs and wonders, but today He's speaking through His word. Not only that, in John, He said, my sheep, which is those who are saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, my sheep hear my voice, they know it, and they move towards it. What is He saying? He's saying that when we hear the word of God, we should be alert because we should know that. But the only way that you're going to know the word of God is that you spend time with God. So that's the first one. God has chosen prayer as a communication that He may communicate with. Number two, prayer allows us to engage God in meaningful conversation. Prayer allows us to gauge God in a meaningful conversation. Because one of the things you got to understand about speaking to God, it's not that you got to have all your words right and perfect in order to speak to God, because the scriptures say even when you come before God and you don't really know what to say, because sometimes we are broken up by this world and the things that are going on in our situation, and we really don't know what to say to God. He said He knows the moans and groans of your heart. He knows your heart and where you're at and what your intent is. That's why I really believe that a lot of times when we go towards things and we really don't have our heart in it, God knows our heart is not in it, and God wants us to be wholeheartedly committed to Him. He don't want us half-hearted committed. That's why He say He don't want us lukewarm. So it's a meaningful way that we communicate with God. Number three, prayer is God designed, mean, or pouring our hearts out to Him. Sometimes we just don't know what to say. I mean, just like I said earlier, we really don't know what to say in prayer, and we make prayer so complicated sometimes. And it's really not that. I mean, you can talk to God just like you talk to anybody else, but you got to respect who He is and His position. But the fact is that whatever is ailing you, God is willing to listen, because God know where you're at in the first place. And know one thing, prayer is not really for God, it's for you, because that's a way that you can communicate and get some of those things off of your heart that's burdening you down, because we have a lot of things a lot of time burdening us down. One of the things that we have too much of today is too many long-range of Christians. We're trying to do it on our own. We've been taught that we can pull our own self up by our bootstraps, but I promise you that's not going to happen. God is orchestrating everything. No matter what you may think or what you may see, God is still in control. Don't get confused. God is in control. He can. That's why I said earlier that it's nothing that we can't pray for, and it's nothing that God cannot do. And that's number three. Number four is prayer is our means to seek and receive forgiveness and pledge our allegiance to Jesus Christ and express gratitude for His goodness and unfailing love that will pursue me all the days of my life, Psalms 23:6. Prayer, remember, that's a way that we can come and express our gratitude and just realize that we need to be thankful each day that God has allowed us here on earth. And one of the things that I always tell people, everything done after salvation is done for inheritance. Everything done after salvation is done for inheritance. Once we receive salvation, now we need to work out our salvation, not work for our salvation, but to work it out that we may store up our treasures in heaven. That's why He tells us not to do that. So in order for us to know what it is that God wants us to do, we have to communicate. We have to communicate through prayer. We have to communicate through reading of His word. We have to communicate through going and sitting in His church. We have to communicate through the other saints. And that's the way God wants us communicating. And number four is prayer is a mean of healing, mercy, of grace, of wisdom and guidance, and filling by the Holy Spirit. Prayer, the way you generate the Holy Spirit is that you speak into God, you pray into God, and it generates the Holy Spirit. See, a lot of us have been saved but are not really doing anything with it. That's why Paul could speak to the Corinth and he could tell them, hey, brethren, that you still walking in the flesh. He said, I know you're brethren, I know you've been saved, but he said, you're still fleshly. And that's what we have a lot of today. We have a lot of Christians that are still fleshly. And God is saying, hey, I need you to draw near to me and I will draw near to you. One of the things that I've learned about God is this. He's not a pushy God. God's not going to push Himself on you. But the fact is, He wants His children to love Him because of who He is. Just like anybody else, you don't want your husband or your wife loving you because you make them love you. You don't want to cry to make them love you. You don't want to entice them to make them love you. You want them to love you because of who you are. And that's the way God wants us to be. So we need to be thankful for prayer. We really do. We need to be thankful for prayer. And just remember, prayer is a means for us communicating with God. Prayer is a means of us hearing from God. Prayer is a means of us praying for one another, because He said the healing process takes place when we confess our sin. As a matter of fact, 1 John 1:9, God has put in place for us, because He hadn't called us to carry these burdens. God, once Jesus Christ died on the cross, He died for the sins that you've already done, that you're going to do, and He's taken care of once and for all. So He don't continue to die for your sins. He's already died for it. Hey, there you have it. I'm going to challenge men to begin. Number one is to seek God in prayer for yourself, and then to seek God on behalf of your wife and your children, and also too, as you are brought out from now, your community and your family and friends, but most of all for your family. Hey, until I see you next time, may God bless you and keep you, as our prayer. And remember, an unexamined life is an unbalanced life. God bless you.